Allô, bonjour. Good afternoon to everyone at home. Welcome from the Canadian Museum for Human Rights in Winnipeg, Manitoba. Bon après-midi et bienvenue de la part du Musée canadien pour les droits de la personne à Winnipeg, au Manitoba. We have a very special program to share this afternoon. Nous présentons un programme bien spécial cet après-midi. I'm Angeliki, interpretive program developer with the public programs team here at the museum. Je suis Angeliki, conceptrice de programme ici au musée. Before we begin the program, I would like to share with you the language and accessibility features available in this session. Avant de commencer, j'aimerais signaler les fonctions de langue et d'accessibilité que nous offrons pour ce programme. The presentations today will be in English. To access French simultaneous interpretation, select the circular globe icon in the Zoom controls at the bottom of the Zoom window. There, you can select the French language channel, and if you would like to hear the interpreted language only, you can select Mute Original Audio. Les présentations d'aujourd'hui seront en anglais. Pour accéder à l'interprétation simultanée en français, sélectionnez l'icône du globe dans les commandes de Zoom au bas de votre écran Zoom. Vous pouvez y sélectionner le canal de langue française et si vous souhaitez entendre uniquement la langue interprétée, vous pouvez sélectionner couper la version audio originale. As you may have noticed already, we also have ASL interpretation available for this program. To view the ASL interpreters, click View Options in the top right corner and then select Gallery View. Vous avez probablement déjà remarqué que nous offrons l'interprétation en ASL pour ce programme. Pour voir les interprètes d'ASL, cliquez sur Options d'affichage dans le coin en haut à droite, puis choisissez Vue Galerie. We also have English and French captioning available for this program. You can access English captions using the MIDI controls at the bottom of your Zoom window or by clicking on the link provided in the chat. To access French captions, click on the link provided in the chat. Nous offrons également des sous-titres en anglais et en français. Vous pouvez accéder aux sous-titres en anglais à l'aide des contrôles de la réunion au bas de votre écran Zoom ou en cliquant sur le lien fourni dans le chat. Pour les sous-titres en français, cliquez sur le lien fourni dans le chat. The museum is located on ancestral lands on Treaty 1 territory. The Red River Valley is also the birthplace of the Métis. We acknowledge with gratitude the water in the museum is sourced from Shaw Lake 40 First Nation. Le musée se trouve sur des terres ancestrales sur les territoires visés par le traité numéro 1. La vallée de la rivière Rouge est également le berceau du peuple Métis. Nous reconnaissons avec gratitude que l'eau du musée provient de la première nation Shaw Lake numéro 40. At CMHR, we are committed to engaging our audiences in respectful dialogue by providing a safe space for all. We welcome your participation with comments and questions. We ask that you stay on topic and be respectful of others as if you were having a face-to-face discussion. Thank you for respecting the rights, differences and opinions of others. Au musée, nous sommes résolus à engager nos publics dans un dialogue respectueux en offrant un espace sûr pour tout le monde. Partagez vos commentaires et vos questions. Nous vous demandons de rester dans le sujet, de respecter les autres, comme si vous aviez une discussion face à face. Merci de respecter les droits, les différences et les opinions des autres. You can use the Q&A section to send your questions for our speakers and our moderators. It will be open during the presentation and the Q&A section of the program. To ask a question, open the Q&A window, type your question in the Q&A box and click send. We will try to respond to as many questions as possible by texting the Q&A window or in the live presentation. Vous pouvez utiliser la fonction QR pour envoyer vos questions à nos intervenants et aux modérateurs. Cette fonction sera ouverte pendant la présentation et la période des questions. Pour poser une question, ouvrez la fenêtre QR, tapez votre question dans le case et cliquez sur le bouton pour nous l'envoyer. Nous essaierons de répondre à autant de questions que possible par texte dans la fenêtre QR ou en direct pendant la présentation. It is a privilege to connect with you for our virtual program today, which in Canada marks Genocide Remembrance, Condemnation and Prevention Month. C'est un privilège pour nous de communiquer avec vous pour notre programme virtuel aujourd'hui, qui marque au Canada le mois de la commémoration de la condamnation et de la prévention des génocides. Now, let me introduce our moderators, Gary and Andrea Dyck. Gary and Andrea lived in the Xinjiang Uyghur Autonomous Region of Canada, which is also known as East Turkestan, from 2008 until 2018. They did 5 years of language and cultural studies in Mandarin and Uyghur, and in the last 5 years ran a large-scale compost business as a social enterprise to assist low-income farmers. Gary is now executive director of the Mennonite Heritage Village in Steinbach, Manitoba. Andrea is a family coach and child development educator. She's currently working on her master's in counseling psychology. Permettez-moi maintenant de vous présenter les modérateurs Gary et Andrea Dyck. Gary et Andrea ont vécu dans la région autonome Ouïghour de Xinjiang en Chine, également connue sous le nom de Turkestan oriental, de 2008 à 2018. Ils ont fait 500 des études linguistiques et culturelles en mandarin et en Ouïghour et durant les 5 dernières années ont géré une entreprise de compostage à grande échelle en tant qu'entreprise sociale pour aider les agriculteurs à faible revenu. Gary est maintenant directeur général du Mennonite Heritage Village à Steinbach, Manitoba. Andrea est coach familial et éducatrice en développement de l'enfant. Elle travaille actuellement à sa maîtrise en psychologie du counseling.
Thank you, Angeliki. Yes, we and our three children loved living in China and in the Uyghur region in northwest China. And the Uyghur people, just to let you know, in case you don't, is the Eastern Turkish ethnicity, and they number over 11 million. We were there to see the lead up and the first years of the genocide.
Genocide is a process, not a single event. A key feature of the genocidal process is that it is not only a systematic, but also a patterned form of attack on a group. People's real and perceived positions in the target society are instrumentalized by perpetrators to cause maximal and lasting physical and psychic damage to group members and to institutions of group cohesion, especially the family unit. Dr. Jodin, 4G, 2019.
In the early stages, we saw increased restrictions, security checkpoints between cities, razor wire on walls, convenience police stations set up at every major intersection.
We saw airport level security installed at all stores, parks, and restaurants, with Uyghurs getting extra scrutiny.
We saw the village streets becoming emptier and emptier as 2017 moved along. People taken away or afraid to be noticed.
Eventually, very few households still had all of their family members at home. Some were taken to the camps, others were required to rotate among the village homes, teaching the new restrictions and watching on their fellow Uyghurs.
Beards, prayer mats, and religious ceremonies became very suspect.
Skirt length and headscarves were scrutinized. In some areas, households were required to buy couches instead of using their traditional floor mats.
We saw security checkpoints now coming in between villages. For myself, driving to work took longer as there were sometimes several roadblocks and police checks. Facial recognition and definition cameras were now more pervasive.
Our son's teenage friends were afraid to turn 18, as it meant they would also face the threat of being taken.
We saw megaphones and speakers installed on every street so you cannot escape the blaring sounds and anthems of how to behave.
Women who had never cut their hair since childhood had to keep their heads bare at the weekly public meetings. They stood there with their hands covering their faces in shame and eventually cut their hair off to comply.
Use of electricity and gas was monitored. I could no longer buy gas for my van without borrowing a local ID card from someone, which then became risky to that person, as no one wanted the follow-up police call for buying too much gas.
Walking the streets, there was a strange forced calm. The police on the corners and the shop owners along the streets regularly practice drills as though a terrorist attack could happen at any moment. Pedestrians suppressed all emotion to avoid any unwanted attention.
One day, as I was going by a market gate, I saw an older man, not allowed in. In frustration, he pushed someone. A signal was given, and within seconds, guards and police vans rushed to the scene and surrounded him.
6 a.m. morning calls began on the suburban and village streets near where we lived. Police would blow their whistles, and within minutes, everyone had to arrive for their picture. They would all be asked, "Are you happy? How is your marriage? Is everyone home and happy?"
We saw a re-education camp just down the street from our home being built and set up. We knew this was not a happy time.
Our first presenter today is Dr. Adrian Zenz. Dr. Zenz is a senior research fellow in China studies at the Center of the Victims of Communism Memorial Foundation, an education, research, and human rights nonprofit based in Washington, D.C. He was one of the first researchers to reveal proof of the situation and the conditions in the Xinjiang camps, and has continued to do extensive research on the Uyghur genocide over the years. We're grateful to you, Dr. Zenz, for your work in this area, and we look forward to hearing what you bring to us today.
Thank you indeed very much for having me at this event. It's my pleasure to be here and to present. And as I have also said before in the interview with the Globe and Mail, the museums have a special role to play in this because this is an ongoing atrocity. And even more importantly, it's important to compare this to historical situations and to have the historic awareness in order to actually be proactive and prevent atrocities and genocide as they are occurring, and not only to document them when they have long passed and the victims are lost. I will be presenting today with a PowerPoint presentation on a number of aspects in relation to this atrocity and how it developed over time. So to start, just a very brief map. There's 11 to 12 million Uyghurs. The total affected population, however, are all Turkic ethnic minorities, including Kazakhs, Kyrgyz, Tajiks, even Hui Muslims, and so on. So we're talking about 15 to 16 million people who are affected by this atrocity. If we look at how it unfolded very briefly, we can sort of see a phase one, 2014 to 16, after the visit of President Xi Jinping, where you had a situation of a police state that was being built up with police recruitments, neighborhood police stations, surveillance systems. Then you had the mass internment in camps from 2017 to 19. And then you had the situation, you have a shift into the long-term strategy, which is forced labor, a separation of children from parents, and birth prevention. And here we are, of course, looking at sort of genocide territory, like there's some boxes here being ticked off the United Nations Convention for the Prevention of the Crime of Genocide. So police recruitments, Andrea and Gary have, of course, already given a much more vivid impression of that than I would be able to. Statistically speaking, you see how in 2009, with the Urumqi riots, police recruitment, this is advertised police positions in Xinjiang per capita, they're per, I think this should be 100,000 or 10,000 of the population, increased 3 to 4 times prior to the previous state. But then under Chen Xuanguo, and we are now looking at 2016 and 17, this increased 30 to 40 times of the level of 2007. Chen Xuanguo set up and ramped up the police state, especially in 2016 and 17. He hit the ground running, which is why this was so premeditated. In my opinion, we can make a good argument that the police state and the internment campaign is all very premeditated, because he immediately, when he came onto Xinjiang in August 2016, within 12 months, he achieved the police state built up. And this was preparation for the subsequent internment campaign to just make sure that the Uyghurs could not rise up and do anything about the mass internment campaign. The mass internment campaign, many of these facilities were actually, well, there were inceptions before and in 2016, but many facilities were constructed in 2017. Uyghurs were often initially rounded up in temporary facilities, even middle schools, and larger, more dedicated facilities were built in 2017 and then 18 and expanded. In 19, here you see a watchtower. This is a German television driving past, capturing the watchtower of what's supposedly a vocational training center to train Uyghurs in good job skills. And here you see in the very center of the satellite image, you see the initial phase of the Schule County re-education camp. And then the red parts were added later on in 2018 and 19. So a huge massive expansion of internment facilities. And of course, the one in the bottom left corner with the blue roofs and the red circle around it, those are factories. So you're starting to see the first signs of forced labor here. Moving on, since I don't have a lot of time for this presentation. So what is the long-term strategy here? The internment camps themselves are described in an unusually frank Chinese academic research report called the Nankai Report, refers to the internment camps as a short-term intensive method, followed by the long-term strategy. What is the long-term strategy? Well, firstly, it's separating parents from children. Secondly, forced labor and labor transfers. And thirdly, birth prevention to limit Uyghur population growth and make them easier to control. So even preschools, this is a preschool, even preschools are like fortresses. Actually this picture could be either preschool or primary school, I can't remember, but the point is even preschools, the all schools from preschool to high school are equipped with barbed wire, with anti-vehicle barriers, with surveillance systems. Some kindergartens have a three-tiered intrusion detection system with electric fencing. This is another close-up from the Associated Press, a primary school. And really what the state is achieving, just to stay here, is a long-term generational change. Break their roots, says one of the documents. Break the roots, break the cultural, the spiritual roots, change them, raise them with the ideology of the party and the government. So this is a long-term change strategy. Of course, in Canada and other places, there have been attempts to do this with native populations through colonial schools to change them for good. Demographic genocide. There are documents, the chart shows, the orange line is Xinjiang's sterilizations per 100,000 of the population, shooting up in 2017 and 18, way above the national level, which at this time, China actually relaxed birth control regulations and allowed two children instead of just one. Local government plans in two Uyghur counties show plans to sterilize between 14 and 34% of women of childbearing age. Just stunning for 2019 this was. Dramatic declines in natural population growth rates. The Uyghur in southern Xinjiang, natural population growth between 2015 and 18 declined by 73.5%, an absolutely incredible, dramatic decline. And in 2019, they have chosen to no longer publish birth rates, only for Xinjiang as a whole, but not by county, not by prefecture. So you can't say. Kashgar also, no more publishing of this. One Uyghur region set a growth target, a birth rate target of only 1 per mil, which is nearly zero for 2020 to be achieved through family planning work. One of the important things is that this decline in birth rates cannot just be explained through the internment campaign, but it is related to a state sponsored system. So the government has implemented a system and a policy of birth prevention. Of course, the internment camps have further suppressed birth rates, but, and that's very important. This is not just a side effect of the internment campaign, this is a dedicated policy. And that's where we're looking at the intent to control, even reduce a population. Forced labor also plays an important role. Under the guise of development, the Chinese state calls it industry-based poverty alleviation. The ethnic minorities are put into so-called poverty alleviation workshops, where they are a place to work either directly from internment camps or generally from labor transfer of agricultural surplus workers. So the forced labor is much bigger than the internment. The forced labor impacts more or less most adults, most ethnic minority adults from the countryside who were not already in some sort of a full-time wage employment. So it's a very big scheme. And of course, again, the point is to change livelihoods, change control, place Uyghurs in government-controlled environments. They cannot go to the mosque on Friday. They can't fast in a work environment. There's cameras. Oftentimes they're on highly securitized compounds. And so that is part of the long-term strategy of the state to control and change these people. You might have heard about textile and cotton. You might have heard about the garment industry, fashion industry being implicated. Well, the fashion industry and textile is one of the big targets of the forced labor, the labor transfer policy. It's into low-skilled labor intensive manufacturing, mostly textile and garments. They want to have 1 million workers in that by 2023. We're also talking electronics, assembly, low-skill, footwear, toys, furniture, handicraft, that kind of thing. Xinjiang, of course, plays an important role in the Belt and Road Initiative. And this is also designed it's a business of oppression, really. It's making money off the oppression of the Uyghurs. It makes the police state more sustainable because the police state is expensive to maintain. This increases Xinjiang's economic base. Estimated 80,000 Uyghurs have been transferred to work in other parts of China between 2017 and 2020. So what can be done? This is an ongoing atrocity, which however has already moved from phase one police state to phase two internment to phase three long-term strategy through birth prevention, parent-child separation and forced labor. Governments must condemn this atrocity. And I think it's very important that it's not just the parliaments who do this, which is important, but also the governments themselves formally recognize the nature of this atrocity and force multilateral institutions such as the United Nations to acknowledge, to actually even talk about it. This has been a huge problem. Secondly, the business of oppression, of forced labor must be stopped. Here, consumers can do things. Anybody can actually contribute this to this. Write to companies, increase awareness. I think here, there's the reliance on politicians and politics drops a little bit. And I think that's very important. Probably one of the reasons why China actually is suing me over my forced labor research, because it actually hits them where it hurts economically. And it's actually possibly in the long run, the bigger problem for them, because regular Western consumers can act on this. Atrocity appraisals by governments or United Nations followed by sanctions. It's important that governments fully speak out about the nature of this atrocity and declare it for what it is, but then also follow this up with action. I think sanctions are appropriate because they send a signal. And I think it's important to see none of these measures, all of these measures may or may not change the situations for the Uyghur on the ground, like improve, lead to tangible improvement. But that's not the point. You know, I think if the Uyghurs who are languishing in hopelessness know that the world cares about them and talks about them and knows about them and does something, even something symbolic like sanctioning the party officials responsible, that by itself is so important. It's so important sometimes just to do the right thing. And then we have to leave the ramifications up to the justice that's hopefully built into our society and world. And over the long run, you never know what can happen if you do the right thing. Ultimately, this is an ongoing atrocity. And if all of us do the right thing, we can really make a difference in this. Imagine if people had done this in 1939 to 45. Imagine what difference could have been made. We are in the midst of this, and we have so much more information than people had in 1942 in regards to the Jews. Thank you.
Thank you, Adrian. That was wonderful. We really appreciate your work. And it's very good for all of us to know. And thank you for kind of distilling in four key areas the Uyghur plight. Now, it's my pleasure and privilege to introduce Mehmet Tohti. Mr. Tohti is a prominent Uyghur Canadian activist who has campaigned for the rights of Uyghurs over a decade. He is a co-founder of the World Uyghur Congress and executive director of the Uyghur Rights Advocacy Project based in Ottawa. I have been following his work the past couple of years and find him to be a wise, thoughtful, ardent person to whom we should listen carefully. Welcome here, Mr. Tohti.
Thank you, Gary, and thank you, Angelica. And thank you for Canadian Museum for Human Rights. And I remember that I worked hard in 2006, 2007, just a campaign for the establishment of museum. And it is nice to be back and share the same podium. Thank you, Dr. Adrian and Dr. Adrian Zenz for his excellent presentation. The Uyghur Rights Advocacy Project is Ottawa-based research, documentation, and advocacy project. We do research and we document on the basis of research, and also on the basis of the documentation, we do advocacy work, and we share our resources with Uyghur organizations and other activists and researchers around the world. And today, we are talking about Uyghur family destruction, genocidal tool of Chinese government. And a little while ago, and Gary yourself, you mentioned about the destruction of Uyghur family unit. And also Dr. Adrian Zenz talked about the mass internment and massive displacement. And at the end, we have to realize that these policies are affecting the families, family integrity and the family foundation. And the Uyghur Rights Advocacy Project, we studied more than 600 family files of Uyghur victims. We collected since 2018 till now. And after our year and a year and a half studying of these files, you can see the files here. And this is, by the way, it is volunteer submission. We did not ask any Uyghurs to submit. And we did not give them any format, what kind of information should be included in their testimony. This is a purely volunteer-based submission. And we receive it, and we kept in a confidential base, and we uploaded all the information to secure system, and we studied nearly 600 family files just to figure out what kind of atrocities they have gone through and are still going through. And after our study, we found that the Uyghur family destruction is underreported, the genocidal tool of the Chinese government through family separation. And I have to make it clear, when we talk about family separation, it is the process. The end goal of family separation is the destruction of Uyghur families. And how it happens? It happens through family separation, by interning the millions of them in concentration camps and prisons and a lengthy imprisonment. And the refusal to issue passports or a confiscation of passports from those already have it, or visa refusal and preventing family reunification. And we are talking about family separation through coerced divorce, and the Chinese government forced people, the Uyghurs inside, and divorce their partners living outside. And a family separation through enforced disaffiliation of family members living abroad, just denunciation of family members. disown the family members. And especially recently, we have seen more propaganda videos by the Chinese government and putting one family member against another or disaffiliating them. You are not my son, you are not my brother. Please don't disturb our life. We see a lot of Chinese government's propaganda video recently. And also we are talking about family separation through enforced disappearance. Just I have to mention that there is one Xinjiang database and shahidbiz.com. Since 2017 till 2020, they have received more than 10,500 the testimonies about their missing family members, all of them enforced as a result of enforced disappearance. And Human Rights Watch and other human rights organizations documented since 2009. And also we are talking about the family separation through displacement. Dr. Adrian Zenz just mentioned about that. Just displacing the young Uyghur male and the female in reproductive age and spreading them outside of their homes, in majority cases, scattering them all across China and forcing them to work under semi-military control. And we are talking about family separation of state-appointed ethnic Chinese in homestay program. Homestay means sleep, live, eat together, and share on the same bed. And finally, we are talking about family destruction through mass gang rape of Uyghur male and female detainees. And so these are the forms of family separation with the end result or intended goal of family destructions. And so this is the result not only from our study, from the victim testimonies, at the same time, some of them, it is the result of our direct interviews with the camp survivors and the credible reports. And so because of the time limit, I cannot present all of the slides. We are going to publish this report very soon. And so instead, I would like to share the two testimonies. And one testimony is about just recent one, a Canadian gentleman whose name is Kamal Torson. He's a Canadian citizen. He came to Canada in 2003 and he left his hometown in 1999. And recently, the doctor G. Blevin from Alberta, he wrote a letter to immigration. To Canada Immigration, I'm writing this letter with regards to Kamal Torson, who was admitted to the hospital on April 7, 2021, and has been diagnosed with terminal neurological disease. Mr. Torson would like to see his daughter, Gulgina Kamal, who lives in China. He has not seen her since leaving China. And basically, just this person wants to see her daughter before his last breath. As a Canadian, because Chinese government did not issue a passport for her daughter, for his daughter, and separated this family. And this family is devastated. This gentleman is hospital bed right now in terminal ill. And I would like to read another one testimony. My name is Tahir Amin. I live in Washington, DC. I left China in February 2017 to study at Haifa University in Israel. Chinese authorities asked me to go back to China in May 2017. I continued my studies and went to US in August 2018. After I came to US, my wife was forced to divorce me and was constantly interrogated because of me. Since then, I lost all contact. And that there are a lot of testimonies like this. And what does it tell to us? What is the end goal of these forms of family separation? It's the destruction of Uyghur families and the Uyghur family unit in the part of the government mandated program, just to break the lineage, break the roots, break the connections, break the origin. And so this is the translated format of those doctrine into daily politics. And so Oftentimes, we read the media report about the missing family members, but we really do not go deep. What is the end result of this family separation? And so basically, Chinese government is using family separation to achieve the Uyghur family destruction and using it as a genocidal tool. And some of the forms of family separation or the acts that Chinese government committed, it is the part of not only the part of the genocide definition, at the same time, it is part of crime against humanity. And so at the end, what we can do, and we have to be very mindful. And this program is explicitly declared by the Chinese government and vigorously being implemented with mandate by mobilizing all state actors, just like all level of governments, at the same time, non-state actors, just like companies, public sectors, telecom, or other. And so this is the integrated policy by the government, just targeting a core foundation of Uyghur families through separation and through breast prevention and others, ultimately destroying the Uyghur family unity and the family integrity, family structures. And so now today, probably I have to mention here, UK Parliament also unanimously passed a resolution acknowledging the atrocities committed by Chinese government against Uyghurs as a genocide and a crime against humanity. Our parliament has also voted on February 22nd and acknowledged what is happening, what is going on is genocide. And now with the public pressure and with the awareness raising like this, we have to call our government to take action. They have to start first acknowledging the atrocity as genocide. After the acknowledgement, we have a better chance to work with our allies and other partners to convince them to acknowledge and then take some concrete action, because we have a legal obligation. After we acknowledge the genocide, we have a legal obligation to stop it and punish those who are responsible for those crimes. At the same time, we have a responsibility to protect those victims. Maybe we cannot do anything so within current capacity to those who are living in China, but at least we can do something who are living outside. And for that reason, we have to look into our family reunification program, and the Immigration of Canada should review, because some family reunification program takes long time to process. And especially at this time, as Chinese government creates all kind of hurdle in the process, it became almost impossible to achieve family reunification, and we have to look into some other options. And also, we have to look into our internal regulations, and oftentimes we ask the family members when they sponsor, we ask tons of information, which is impossible right now to obtain from Chinese government. And we have to look into those regulations, and we have to make some adjustments. And this is the issue that we have to address as of now. At least there are people still we can extend our helping hands and save them from the atrocities. And it affects the generational, this has a generational impact, not only the Uyghurs inside and at the same time Uyghurs outside. Just from myself, since 1991, I'm totally isolated from my mother and siblings and all of my close or indirect relatives as a result of this family separation policy. So we have to address this, and we have to adjust our policies and help those victims. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Tohti. Yes, when we lived there, we were there in the first stage, in the earlier stages, and we saw a constant threat of separation. Women I knew were kept so busy with overnight work requirements, marching, and extra work, they couldn't go home to feed their children. A woman I knew was responsible to care for the elderly parents and young children in her extended family. And once she was taken to a camp, life became impossible for that family. Even those who weren't taken to the camps were living in separation because of extra requirements. And those still at home faced the constant threat of being sent off to schools. One woman was talking to me and just said, all day at work, I hear employers saying, if you don't do this, I send you to the schools. If you don't do this, I send you to the schools.
Yeah. And I have some breaking news here. The UK Parliament, they were having their vote actually today about the genocide in Xinjiang. And I'm happy to announce that they voted unanimously to declare China's treatment of Uyghur Muslims in the Xinjiang region as genocide. So that follows in the wake of US, Canada, Netherlands. And so we're happy to announce that today. Now we will open it up for the interaction here for your questions. We thank you. The questions have been coming in and we appreciate your interest. And we want to keep going through with this discussion and with Adrian and Mehmet. Thank you so much.
Dr. Zenz, one person has asked, what kind of birth prevention, what does that look like?
So the goal, according to government documents, is quote-unquote long-term effective birth prevention. And in southern Xinjiang, that typically refers to the insertion of intrauterine devices, which are non-removable. They can be removed only by government-approved clinics or tubal ligation sterilizations. In some cases, it would also refer to like a medication, but that would be sort of the typical method. We have also some quantitative evidence for that from a number of counties.
And Mr. Tohti, do any nations have the incentive they need, the courage they need to deal with China on this genocide?
Thank you for the question. Yeah, there is. We see some weakening movement right now from United States and Canada, as you just announced, from UK and then Netherlands and other countries. At least this topic is under discussion and increasing level in the political level. And also there is a great push for relevant institutions of United Nations to address this. And also there is some, the Chinese government at home also is increasingly feeling this pressure. And so I think from Canadian perspective, I can talk more about from Canadian perspective. And the recently announced sanction, I guess it is the first step, and we have to adjust many of the policies that we set previously. And we call status quo, and it takes some time to address that policy. At the same time, to implement a new set of trade policy with China and a new set of other the dimensional change in relation to China. So I think this is the process of it is the beginning, and this process is should continue. And with the increasing pressure, I think within the next year, probably we are going to see more actions from our international allies.
Yeah, I've heard different governments talk about, you know, we need to work collaboratively about this. Yeah, definitely. Not one country on one country, yeah. But.
Another question came in about the people living in the people living in the Uyghur village homes, the Han going around, and the different people that had to live in the homes.
Family programs.
Yeah, and the person asking the question said, it's quite alarming that these people would be sleeping with children and being in the home as they watch if people are speaking Mandarin in the home and these things. And I felt it was very, very alarming. A lot of these homes, the husband has already been taken off to a camp. And so it's unspeakable how alarming that would be for a Muslim family to have lost privacy to that extent.
Dr. Adrian, here's one for you. Someone was wondering about the testimonies, or Mehmet too, Where can they find these testimonies that you both talked about?
So I can just be very brief here because I work really primarily with government documents and not really primarily with testimonies. But the testimonies that I work with are published. Most recently, a very detailed testimony was published by the New Yorker magazine. Testimonies, for example, of women specifically related to birth prevention, forced sterilization, etc., were published by the Associated Press in the summer of last year, together with my article, and then also by The Guardian.
We are going to release our report within maximum 2 weeks time. And so whoever interested, they have a chance to read the original Uyghur testimony and the exact translation into English version. And for safety and security reason, for the protection of identity of those victims, and we have to blur the names and some specific identification of those victims and the rest of them. It will be included our the report that would be published within 2 weeks. They can visit www.urap.ca, Europe.ca, or a first letter of Uyghur Rights Advocacy Project.
Thank you. One attendant has asked, Dr. Zenz, are you reading these documents in Chinese? How are you accessing them?
Yeah, of course. I work entirely in Chinese in my research, both in searching them and in reading them. And sometimes when I do one-to-one translation, I use the help of my native Chinese-speaking research assistant. But my work is conducted in Chinese, which actually is one of the reasons why I was more obscure as a researcher for a long time, because I don't speak ethnic minority languages. So in a sense, doing Chinese-based research was for a long time a disadvantage until this came around.
So you don't know Uyghur, I guess, right?
No.
Yeah,
which is strange, but now it's a huge, well, it's not a benefit not to speak Uyghur, but it's a huge benefit to have done all this work in Chinese. And that's why I also find these things, because I've done this for many years in Chinese.
We have another question here. Perhaps both of you could answer this one as well. Do the Uyghur people have political representation? And what means of advocacy do they have on the ground?
Just let me go first with your permission, Dr. Zen. And I don't know just what that person means, the inside of East Turkestan or outside of East Turkestan. So the answer depends upon the what he means. And inside of East Turkestan, no, there is no political representation. And it is the Chinese Communist Party, single party system, and the Chinese central government appointed puppets there for showcase. For outside of China, yes, there is Uyghur organization, and notably the World Uyghur Congress representative body working with all Uyghur organizations as umbrella organization, working with all Uyghur organizations across the globe. And basically they have the mission to achieve. One is promotion of the rights of Uyghur people and to protect their culture and the rights at the same time, seek the political solutions through a dialogue and a non-violent way to secure the rights of Uyghur people to determine their own political future. And if you visit the uyghurcongress.org, you can see the mission statement and what that organization is doing. It is open source information.
Dr. Zenz, did you have a response to that question? Do the Uyghur people have political representation, and what means of advocacy do they have on the ground?
On the ground? they are liable to be put into police custody or an internment camp if, as the Dicks have shared themselves, if they happen to accidentally trip over the foot of a police officer. I don't think much more needs to be said about their political representation in China. Of course, the Chinese ethnic minority system has, of course, a system of autonomy autonomous region and an autonomous governor. So you have an ethnic minority governor, you have a Uyghur governor, Tibetan governor, and then a Chinese party secretary. And the one who has the power is the party secretary. And I've actually argued in my own past research over 10 years ago that ethnic Tibetans have to some extent succeeded in using some of that system to their benefit. Even back then it was very difficult, very, very challenging before Xi Jinping. And under Xi Jinping, of course, that all changed very rapidly. And now Xinjiang is a complete police state, and Uyghurs are co-opted in the system. So Uyghurs, you'll see Uyghur politicians saying that Uyghurs are doing great and these camps are just really wonderful places where people play basketball.
Yeah, just a lot of the police that were marching on the streets and things that we saw were, a lot of them were Uyghurs being used for that role. There was, and like I said, they're often look so calm, everyone's calm on the streets. There was one day I was walking to the shops and I saw a line of 8 of these young men marching in uniform. And there was one man that just stuck out to me. His face was not calm and he looked embarrassed and frightened. And his face has stuck out to me.
Mehmet Tohti, how are the Uyghurs in Canada doing? And you know, one question specifically too after that is there lobbying to the federal government to push for Uyghur family reunification?
Yeah. The Uyghurs and working on their behalf in Ottawa. And we have been working with our parliamentarians, elected officials at the same time with all level of government officials, just to promote the rights of Uyghur people and creating awareness about this genocide. It took some while, and at least now there is some action from political level, especially from parliamentary level. And for government, I think now with the new administration in the United States and the Canadian government seems to be more emboldened. And they have ongoing problem with China, especially for our two Michaels and the other detained Canadians. Now with the backing of United States, and it's time for Canada to take much stronger action. And because nearly 90% of Canadians, they have a certain sort of views against China. At the same time, they supported the parliamentary acknowledgement of Uyghur genocide. In this case, the parliament has spoken and the Canadian public also spoken, and it's time for government to take the already announced action into next level.
So what can Canadians do to come alongside the things, the advice that you're giving?
Dr. Zen had appointed a number of suggestions, and I would like to thank all Canadians for their support. And a recent poll showed more than 83% of Canadians already support the parliamentary motion acknowledging Uyghur genocide. That is good. Really, it is comforting for the sufferer of Uyghurs. And so we have to contact with our elected the federal and the provincial MPs, even city councillors, and to take some drastic measures and to review their current China policy. At the same time, on personal level, as Dr. Adrian Zenz mentioned, we have to be more vigilant and we have to exercise due diligence, what we are consuming and what kind of products we are buying, and with our pocket money that they can go to somewhere to support the forced labor and the genocide. And for that reason, not only textile sectors, at the same time, the tomato sectors, we have to be more careful. We have to check where it is made. At the same time now, the solar panel and the polysilicon and that area also, we have to be very vigilant, and especially government should revisit the January announcement of they are advisory, and they have to put some concrete measures, enforceable measures to stop the importation of those products from the Uyghur region to Canada. And unless strong public support, and the government sometimes is quite reluctant to act, and we have to increase that pressure. So these are the areas that our fellow Canadians can be more active.
Yeah, and then based on that too, Dr. Zenz, are there, someone's asking where the specific corporations that are using forced labor, where can they be found, just so we know what companies are part of that?
So there is a website called the Uyghur Coalition to End Forced Labor, or the Coalition to End Forced Uyghur Labor. If you Google that, they will have some up-to-date information. The only other way is to look at media reports, to stay up to date with media reports and research, but the research will typically be mentioned in media reports, and they will name names. And it's a moving target, and a couple of companies have been named. I think that's one centralized website that collates the information and staying up to date with media developments and what related these Uyghur activists and others have social media accounts, including people like Mehmet Tohti and the World Uyghur Congress, the Uyghur Human Rights Project, and they will tweet out and share information as it comes out.
Thank you, that's helpful. Dr. Zenz, in your opinion, here's another question. In your opinion, why is so-called Muslim and Turkic speaking states, why do they remain silent on the Uyghur genocide? What will it take to change the situation?
So you have to, so these are governments, right? It's the governments who stay silent. So you have to look at them and their motivation. Now, many of these governments, one can say about 90% of them, have very little interest in human rights, even in their own country. To the contrary, some of them are actually human rights violators. Many of these governments have no interest in helping even other Muslims if it can hurt their own pocket. And China's Belt and Road Initiative happens to actually be influential in much of the Muslim world. The Belt and Road goes right through the Middle East, Southeast Asia, etc. You even unfortunately have democracies where people are Muslims are surprisingly silent. The Muslim world itself sometimes proclaims that it speaks out for each other, but when the rubber hits the road, meaning it's very easy to condemn cartoonists in France or Denmark, right? You lose no money if you do that. You can even threaten to kill them. Sorry for being blunt. But if you, however, anger the government of China, many of these countries are facing potentially substantial financial ramifications because they know that China will not be happy. And it's a very sensitive topic for Beijing. Behind the scenes, China is using a huge amount of influence and probably money to threaten, coerce, and influence these voices and these governments, and they're falling for it. So we are, it's a classic case of self-interest. I think that's the most straightforward explanation.
Okay, and then to take it down more to a kind of a personal individual level, Mr. Tohti, can you talk about how expat Uyghurs, you know, the diaspora, are being intimidated by maybe Chinese authorities or others?
Yeah. This is one of the topics that we have been raising with our Canadian officials since almost 20 years. And mentioned earlier, in my case, I myself isolated since 1991 from my families and without any visit each other. And the many Uyghur activists and many Uyghurs, they have been experiencing this. And the hostage taking was the terminologies that used by Uyghurs 10 years ago. And now we are using that terminology for two Michaels. And basically Chinese government in many cases is a common practice, taking hostage of our family members and compelling their members living abroad to obey the Chinese rule, Chinese laws, or stay silent, abstaining themselves from taking part any rally that goes against China or protesting against China. And sometimes the Uyghurs in Canada are receiving a direct phone call from Public Security Bureau and with the presence of their parents or family members, or sometimes the wife or the husband or children, as a result of hostage taking, and directly threatening them. And now we have seen that they are shifting their policy. And in Canada, there are a lot of infiltrated the forces or people that are actively working for the agenda of the Chinese government as part of academia or a political circle. And we have seen in the media report frequently. And so this is the ongoing issue. Unfortunately, in our federal government, there is no any piece of legislation to address this specific issue. And recently we had one tip line, and it's a phone line. It is general tip line, but it doesn't solve the problem. And this is the area that our federal government should address. And there is a warning from our CSIS officials top level since 2010, as far as I remember, about the Chinese infiltration in our system. Not only the threat, intimidation, and harassment from China, at the same time, here in Canadian soil. And this is the serious issue that our government should address, and our politicians and the parliamentarians should look into it. And just we need to pass a number of legislation, just like Foreign Transparency Act or Foreign Agent Registry Act, as Australia and some other countries did. And unfortunately, we are dragging behind on this critical issue.
Dr. Zenz, can you say more about what specific legal actions are being advanced to UN courts, criminal or international court of justice, and who's leading that?
The International Criminal Court of Justice in The Hague received a request to prosecute or look into the situation of the Uyghurs through treaty countries. China is not a party of the ICC and cannot be directly implicated. So they tried to do this through Tajikistan, another country, and there needs more research needed to be done. So there needs to be this legal link through Uyghur refugees in countries like Cambodia and Tajikistan. And the court said there wasn't enough evidence at the moment because dedicated research has not been done yet on that particular act of Uyghurs being expatriated and at risk by being deported from Tajikistan, Cambodia, and other countries. And so at the moment, and the United Nations is really paralyzed. I mean, look at this. China got a free pass for the human rights review at the end of 2018. They got, and that was, end of 2018 when they first had to admit that there were camps and people were in the camps and countries acquitted them. So China is really good at elite capture, playing the game at the United Nations and working by numbers. Influencing large numbers of smaller countries or developing countries or outright authoritarian countries who are not interested in human rights. And so United Nations has become actually an incredibly impotent mechanism to act on any human rights violation in China, and much, much less to speak of a determination of crimes against humanity or genocide or anything. And so at the moment, one of the more promising initiatives is not associated with a governmental institution, is the Uyghur Tribunal, the Uyghur Genocide Tribunal, that's going to start its hearings in London in early June.
Yeah.
So that's, I think, as far as I can tell, the situation.
Hey, thank you. An interesting question too about Olympics. Is boycotting the 2022 Olympics an effective strategy? I know in February when it came up to the Parliament vote here in Canada, Olympics was also talked about at the Parliament level, and there was some afterwards too talk about what we do as a nation. And I think, yeah, we've seen that, you know, we were there in 2008 when they had the last Summer Olympics in Beijing, and we saw some things. And I don't see this in the news, but this is the insider perspective that I think Andrea will share a little bit here first, and then I want Adrian and Mehmet to share what they think.
So when 2008 happened, we saw a lot of increased restrictions, just even off in Xinjiang, even though it's the other side of the country, there were increased security measures. Other times when there were important meetings, like the fall of 2017, there were meetings in Beijing, and in our part of the country, in Xinjiang, the restrictions just ramped up. Suddenly there could not be any knives used. We couldn't get a chicken butchered because the butchers weren't allowed to use knives. And large semi-trucks on the roads became illegal for that week, and all the produce in the greenhouses rotted. So it just affects people around the country when there's sort of a security thing happening. Dr. Zenz, did you want to comment on this question? Is boycotting the 22 Olympics an effective strategy or not?
I would rephrase the question. I think it's sometimes very good to look at a measure in terms of its effectiveness. How would you define effectiveness? Effectiveness in getting Uyghurs released from camps? No. I would rephrase the question as follows. I would ask, how could you hold the Olympics in a country that is doing this, if you are human? Yeah. We all know, you know, how hard athletes work and train. And we're not comparing this to the Germany games of 1936, because in 1936, the world really didn't know what was going on. And there was maybe one concentration camp, I don't know exactly. We're comparing this to Germany in 1942. I don't know. I just think, I mean, seriously, how could we? What do the Olympics stand for? What are they about? You know, do you want to hold a sports event? I mean, if the Olympics are about anything, then how could we hold them in Beijing in 2022? That's all I want to say.
Thank you so much. I feel that it would put people at further risk, but the risk is already immeasurably high. We have another question here. Shouldn't Canadians and fashion companies be made aware that clothing and fabrics and other products made in China could come from these Uyghur internment workshops? Buying these products supports in a way the genocidal measures.
Yeah, I mean, we kind of have touched on it, but yes, the supply chain and products, that's a really big topic now. And in my opinion, it's now the governments who need to step in, yeah. Right? So China is even retaliating against companies like H&M and Nike, who put out statements saying, oh, there's forced labor in Xinjiang, we're not sourcing from there anymore. This is about Western governments have to take measures to stop imports that are made, that could be made with forced labor. The United States has gone ahead. Other countries need to follow. Steps taken so far by Canada are completely insufficient, in my opinion. So consumers can do something, of course. It's a moving target as well, you know. So it's better if a government just really does their due diligence and preemptively, even if you shut down anything from Xinjiang, that's the right thing to do at the moment, because there's the rebuttable presumption. There's the risk, right? It's a police state with internment camps, forced labor programs, labor transfers. So you just have to, it's better to be preemptive and say no to the whole thing. And then if somebody can prove otherwise, because I think that's also one of the ways that China can be influenced in some way.
Absolutely agree. And especially since the announcement of government of Canada's on January 12th's announcement or advisory on the companies, just calling them to exercise due diligence, it is kind of childish how those companies can exercise due diligence. And let's say one nice gentleman is sitting as a CEO of one Canadian company who wants to exercise due diligence, how he can do that? Can he send some investigation team to the area and they check each step of supply chain, which part is tainted with the forced labor? Does China allow that to happen? And so this is the job for the government, and we have to take enforceable measures, and we have to issue a full ban as United States did. If there is more than 80% or 90% chance of some of the products like cotton or tomato related products already tainted with the forced labor, what else we are looking for? And what kind of due diligence you ask on the companies to exercise? It is the job of the government, and otherwise it is morally unacceptable for me. And I have a young boy, and sometimes I find myself extremely difficult to find something, the clothing to my baby that is not made in China. It is embarrassment. It is sometimes I have to look around number of shops just to find one piece of clothing. And tainted, forced labor tainted products are full everywhere in Canadian shopping malls. And how we can continue to consume those products.
Thank you, yeah. And then, yeah, what is the Chinese, we'll end with this question and then let you share your own thoughts too to conclude, but what is the Chinese government reaction to the various countries of condemning their policies in Xinjiang?
Adrian is the best person to answer this.
Attack researchers, try to portray them as extreme right wing, which is really funny. I vote for Angela Merkel typically, although she's actually going out. So I don't know if that makes me an extreme right wing. I don't think it does. But I don't think I can vote for the party anymore, though, because of their China, the foreign policy of the CDU. A huge disaster at the moment. And I think their new leaders actually, anyways, this is not about getting off topic, but seriously, they're just distracting whataboutism. Oh, you have done human rights problems. You know, never mind George Floyd's murderer was actually convicted and is going to prison, you know? Yeah. Whereas the people who are doing these things against the Uyghurs are being celebrated and promoted politically. So China is hitting back. China is increasingly aggressive. It's doing not just tit for tat, but doing multiple tits for tat. Mm-hmm. And counter-sanctioning people, including myself, academics, politicians, others, trying to target Western companies who have said, oh, there's a forced labor problem. We no longer source from Xinjiang. Coercing countries like Sweden, smaller countries like Sweden or Australia, were trying to say something about different things. And of course, they're also intimidating other, especially Belt and Road countries and countries who are benefiting financially. Kazakhstan, for example, many witnesses or former camp detainees are Kazakh and were able to return to Kazakhstan, flee Xinjiang, and are now being detained by Kazakh security forces, beaten up by unknown street gangs. Stuff like this. China is pulling levers and is effectively leveraging its economic might. We've heard about the threatening of Uyghurs who speak out. Radio Free Asia Uyghurs, their family members in Xinjiang are put in camps simply because these Radio Free Asia Uyghur journalists are reporting on the situation. They are using every means they can, hostage diplomacy in that way, and now increasingly threatening economic retaliation and other retaliation because of their economic power. But they're not just doing that about Xinjiang, they're also doing this on other topics. And so I think it's time for democracies in the world, not just the West, anywhere. And we can be open about our mistakes, you know? I mean, yeah, white privilege, yes, racism, yes. Let's tackle our own blind spots and injustices at home. But we free countries, we need to just stand together, not in saber rattling, but in a sober recognition that our own liberties are being threatened and that we have to do something about the Uyghur atrocity, even if China hits back at us. And I think we need to be multilateral. We need to work together, not America first or Canada first or anybody first, but working together calmly and doing good research and doing fact-based advocacy and political and diplomatic and other measures.
Yeah, let me add a couple of sentences. Yeah, Dr. Adrian Zenz is absolutely right. And also we have to realize that nearly 70% of the Chinese foreign reserve or foreign currency reserve still are coming from Canada, US, and European Union and the Western countries. We have to realize that. And so when China hits back, maybe at some point Canada or some other countries, as Adrian said, when we work together and when we can have some control in our market to get some of the Chinese goods or China, made in China products, if we have some control on that area, and it is a big hit to China as well, because China is experiencing a shortage of foreign currency right now. And the second thing is, yeah, we shouldn't afraid to hit back. And if we afraid and keep our silence, hey, China is hitting back if we say or do something, just we have to visualize what is going to happen after 10 or 25 years when China gets much stronger. And what kind of world our children will be living, what kind of world they are waking up after 20 years. I urge people to ask these questions, and our Western values and human rights and the rule of law and freedom, it didn't come that easy. And there was a huge sacrifice during the First and the Second World War, nearly millions of life lost. And we established certain value system. It is not perfect, but there is a certain value system. And the China is threatening that value system. And the China is exporting its authoritarianism. And the China is expanding its allies on the basis of those its own kind of terms and the value system. And so it's time for our governments to look at this issue seriously, not only from the Uyghurs today's perspective or atrocity perspective, at the same time for our next generation. It's not about $1 billion or the dollar, this for that, that kind of question. It is our future. And so this is much, much serious issue.
Yeah, and on how much trade dollars we can get for the next couple of years.
Yeah,
and I know in February when they had that parliament vote, after that vote, there were some accusations or, you know, hey, you know, the MPs, they've never been here before and they don't know what they're talking about. Well, I mean, there are quite a few of us out there that have been. And, you know, my wife and I, we loved working there, you know, the compost business, you know, just serving the farmers, working with them and helping things get better. And that's what we want to see. We want to see things that human dignity together, the culture, lifting that up.
So we're almost to the end here. So just in one or two sentences, is there one last word that you'd like to share with us, Dr. Zenz and Mr. Tohti?
Mr. Tohti first.
Yeah, thank you. Thank you for your experience and Gary and Andreas. Thank you, Dr. Zenz. And we are frequently sharing the screen, and I hope this will continue. And your work is important. And also our Canadian audience and the listeners, please be proactive. And as I said, please do not forget to check your daily consumption, what you are buying. At the same time, please look at your internet and check your MP's office and try to contact with them. And we have to push our legislators to introduce some sort of legislation. And we have to encourage our government to be bold in their action against or their reaction against Chinese, the ongoing genocide against Uyghurs. Thank you.
I would encourage everybody to talk about this, to make a big deal out of this, because I don't think it's being recognized for the magnitude of what it constitutes. Social media, elsewhere. I mean, does anybody think that this is getting enough attention given what's going on? I don't think so.
No.
And I think it's time that changes. Thank you.
Thank you. Appreciate that. Very good.
Today, we've heard eyewitness accounts, detailed data research, and an extensive report from the Uyghur community. Thank you so much for being here with us today.
Thank you for taking time with us, the Canadian Museum for Human Rights and the Mennonite Heritage Village, to hear the Uyghur plight and the largest incarceration of a people since the Holocaust. To close with, I want to read a poem I wrote when tears and prose were not enough to contain what I felt about the re-education camps. It's entitled High-Rise Tombs. You've never seen such high tombstones. They arose this year all around the cities. The graveyards multiplied, and yet there were no shots fired, no outbreak of disease. No, everything here is pretty quiet and tidy. But in that quiet, I can hear the writhing of those under the stones and the crying of those who miss them in the village homes. But not too loudly, otherwise they too will be taken into these graveyards of high-rise tombs. The government calls them re-education schools, but they don't fool me. I see the razor wire, the cameras, the guards on their high walls. Thousands, now millions, taken in, but never coming out. When will they stop the building of these modern graveyards? Until there is no one living outside their walls, I fear.
That concludes our program. Thank you to our presenters and our moderators. Thank you for joining us from home. The recording of the event will be posted on the CMHR Facebook page once bilingual captions have been added. Keep checking our website and follow us on social media if you want to be alerted to future museum events. I hope you have a great afternoon. Ceci conclut notre programme. Merci à nos intervenants et à nos modérateurs. Merci de vous être joints à nous depuis chez vous. L'enregistrement de l'événement sera publié sur la page Facebook du musée une fois que les sous-titres bilingues auront été ajoutés. Continuez à consulter notre site web et à nous suivre sur les médias sociaux si vous voulez être informé des futurs événements du musée. Merci.